I like to say that we have the potential, or what we are doing here is changing the game. And I'll get into that. Just by, you know, sometimes people don't understand a little bit about my background and how I ended up here. I was a professional gamer and a very avid gamer in my youth. And I got into digital currency back in 1999. Specifically around games. As games became networked, the intangible assets, the digital currency, the virtual items that existed in these worlds had value because the games were persistent. And so I became the main market maker in the world, buying and selling the digital assets in games like World of Warcraft. And in the early 2000s, built up a supply chain of 400,000 people in China that were playing games like World of Warcraft to mine digital currencies for me that I would sell all over the world. I ran over 90% market share in South Korea, which was the mecca of this sort of thing. I was PayPal's largest merchant for a few years, Google's largest advertiser, launched Alipay, and a bunch of other things. So, you know, that's kind of what led me into this space. This is a brief little trailer on this, which they say before there was Bitcoin. And a bunch of, basically, these are all the early adopters that drove the first wave of, call it, mass adoption.
I struggled for years trying to explain what it was I was doing.
Usually I just say I work with video games, because if I say, you know, I'm a virtual currency broker, people just kind of look at you like, what?
You've got games that are based entirely on selling gold on Facebook. Virtual worlds are creating demands, and somebody's going to have to meet those demands. They don't. Somebody like me would.
It was at that time that I realized that people will spend money on virtual things no differently than they would for tangible things. That was kind of that eureka moment for me. And that's really when my company was on its way to doing $100 million in revenue.
And they said, so what you gotta do, you gotta take all the profit from me, and you gotta give it to us, or we're going to sue you tomorrow.
This is going to end badly. Oh.
And there are a lot of people who hate what we do.
Business versus family. I didn't do well.
This is the future of the industry.
And this is happening on a massive scale in countries like China. The real and virtual starts to blend together.
But I always looked at this as something that could go poof instantly.
This should be out soon. It just premiered. I actually forgot we made this movie. We filmed it 10 years ago, and it just premiered. But since we're in a bit of a bear market, it's worth noting, I got my start in tech back in 1997, raised $88 million for my first company, building what you'd call YouTube, Hulu, and Netflix today. We were a little too early, but back in 1995, Newsweek said the internet was going to fail. It was only used by criminals, it was a fad, and it was going away. And by the year 2000, for those that weren't around, the internet bubble burst, and everybody said the internet was dead, no one can make any money here, you know, it's an academic thing only. And for about 2 years, there was no one in the world that would invest in internet businesses. You know, the public companies like eBay were trading below cash, and they were profitable businesses because the internet had no future. I only mention that because the parallels are somewhat interesting. I'm not sure we're going through our 2000 moment yet, but it will happen at some point. There's obviously a lot of projects that have been funded that shouldn't be funded. And, you know, there'll be corrections as we continue to go and evolve. I like talking about this. Most of you maybe have heard me mention this, but The Starfish and the Spider is probably the best book you can read on decentralization, and specifically talking about decentralization that happens, you know, in cultures, tribes, in nature, not really technically. But the idea is, do you know what happens when you cut the leg off a spider? It walks with a limp. You know, if you cut off its head, it's dead. But with a starfish, if you cut off one of these legs, the leg grows back. If you cut off, you cut the starfish where any part of the center is there, that leg will turn into an entirely new starfish. If you cut it five ways through the middle, it will become five starfish. It's the best example of a decentralized system occurring naturally in nature as we move from centralized to distributed and decentralized systems. Worth noting, I guess, this piece, which is, you know, where the market is right now. The developing world is obviously where the impact of this technology is the greatest. You've got nearly 3 billion people on the planet with no access to financial services, another 2 to 3 billion people on the planet with limited access to financial services. You know, in the early days, or not so much recently, but for a long time, people would come up to me and they'd be like, why should I want Bitcoin? You know, because they live in the United States, for example. And my response would be, you shouldn't. I'm like, what do you mean I shouldn't? I go, well, it's not for you. What do you mean not for me? And I'd be like, well, do you have a bank account? And they're like, yeah. And I'm like, you got a piece of plastic in your pocket that lets you conveniently pay for things. And they'd be like, sheepishly, yeah. And I go, yeah, you've got rule of law. You've got faith in the system. And of the 200 currencies in the world, you've got one that everyone wants more of. This might improve your life by a percentage point or two in savings. And you're not clearly going to be a speculator. So I'm guessing you don't get up every morning to clip coupons. But go south of the border. Go look at Latin America, Africa, Southeast Asia. You know, this is where this technology has the ability to improve people's lives by an order of magnitude. You know, having access to financial services, you know, if you were redesigning Maslow's hierarchy of needs today, is a critical, you know, thing to lead a life in this world. Most of the planet, two-thirds of the population of the planet, doesn't have the basic tools necessary to live a productive life. And that would also mean having consistent access to the internet. You know, these are essential things today. And so the developing world is where we're going to see most of the, call it, mass adoption. The developed world is really about using the technology more as plumbing. It's just to speed up settlement, more efficient, you know, sort of everything. But this is where, you know, I'd be focused depending upon what your projects are. The ICO market is interesting. I love this video. I was one of the founders of MasterCoin. We invented the ICO. We did the first ICO back in the summer of 2013, which is before this chart existed. We didn't call it an ICO back then. We called it a crowd sale. But in the early days of these things, very few people were using these. It was really just people that didn't have access to venture capital. Most people preferred venture capital because you weren't raising large sums of money. You know, the first group that had access to top-tier venture was Ethereum, but they chose to do an ICO anyway because it was how you build a protocol. But it took a long time after that for people to start to use this unless you needed to access capital and you couldn't any other way. The Dow, which taught us a bunch of lessons, most importantly, to do security audits, you know, make sure you adequately kick the tires. But what it showed entrepreneurs is that you could raise more money doing an ICO than you could through traditional methods of venture capital. And then it doesn't take very long for entrepreneurs to say, well, let's go this route instead. Naturally, we've seen everything that's happened now. The ICO market is, you know, somewhat closed. It started closing about 3 to 4 months ago. One of the things that I advise anyone that is looking at these things is doing a private sale and doing it as a signal sort of round, which means go pick the top tier investors that you want, the people you think that would add the most value to your project. You know, make them a deal they can't refuse. And get those people in, and then be prepared for when the market opens. You don't get to decide when you go to market. You know, when you wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning and you want a sandwich, you know, your options are what's open. You don't get to pick when the market is open. And be ready, because the market's relatively closed today. Are we in a bubble? Obviously, there's been somewhat of a correction. I make the argument that absolutely not. You know, during the 90s, in 1999, the dot-com industry, the market of public companies got to $6.7 trillion. You know, the cryptocurrency market is not anywhere close to that. And remember, this is back when the market was really an entirely Western phenomenon, and it wasn't that big. And this was the market looking at the future potential of the technology, and that is not inflation-adjusted. You know, if it was a global phenomenon and inflation-adjusted, I could make an argument that it should be $50 trillion. or 100 trillion. So we're still very much in the early sort of stages of this industry's development. You know, the real bubble today is the stock market, the bond market, the currency markets. Those are the ones that scare me. This is more of the stuff that I like to talk about, which is sort of the aspect of self-development. You know, if you want to make a positive impact in the world, it always starts with you. You know, as a sovereign individual, you only have power really over yourself. And the best way to make an impact is by leading through example. I like to use Japanese references as a sort of tipping the hat to Satoshi. And so this is a Japanese concept known as Ikigai. And that is to figure out what it is that you're good at, what it is that you love, and what the world needs. You can forget the bottom section of what gets you paid, because I've found that if you do what you're good at, and you are doing what you love, and you're at the intersection of what's going to make an impact in the world, that centerpiece is finding your life's purpose. And if you're doing what you love, what you're good at, and what the world needs, if you do that long enough, first of all, it doesn't matter whether or not you're going to make a bunch of money, because you're going to be happy. You're going to be doing what comes to you naturally. And most likely, over time, you're going to get very good at that, and someone's going to need that service, and you probably get paid. But money shouldn't be your focus. You know, the less you make money your focus, often the more of it you're going to make, as odd as that sounds. Another really interesting Japanese concept is coming out of World War II. One of America's main contribution was the ability, if you've ever seen that pyramid of good, fast, cheap, you know, pick two. America's main contribution is the Germans were trying to make good things, and America figured out how to make things fast and cheap. You know, it was essentially massive amounts of things is what ultimately led to the war ending the way that it did. But we got good at making things fast and cheap, not necessarily good, and then we outsourced that, and the rest of the world caught on to that model, and then we supersized it. I like to think of it as we built a world of mediocrity. And especially as you're building projects in this space, you shouldn't be building mediocre things. We need to go back to building good things, which means it takes a while. You know, we're not trying to just build a minimally viable product and push it to market. You're trying to build things that are going to last a very long time and make a big impact in the world. And that starts by building good things again. Things that can withstand hurricanes, if you know they're going to come. Build something that's resilient enough to handle 150-mile-an-hour winds. Not things that are going to blow over easily. And so this Japanese term here is known as Kaizen, which is to continually improve. Don't do things, you know, as easy as you can. Do things as well as you can. And when you get up tomorrow, do it even better. I like to talk about the idea that we're all superheroes, or at least have the potential to be. And we all have superpowers. If you're familiar with Malcolm Gladwell, you know, he talks about your superpowers essentially being the things that you put 10,000 hours into. These are the things that uniquely make you, you know, the person that you are. What are the skills that you've developed and refined over the course of your life? And naturally, most of the things that you're going to get really good at are the things that come naturally to you, but you can learn just about anything if you're willing to work at it hard enough. And so as you develop these skills, you know, you want to be out in the world putting those skills to work. You know, figuring out how you can use these skills to contribute to the projects and the people's lives that you have the, you know, the pleasure of interacting with. And it's the idea of being less focused on yourself, less focused on the me, and if you take that M and you turn it upside down, you end up with we. And that's the idea of this conscious capitalism. You know, paying it forward, if you're familiar with this concept, it's, you know, what I recommend to people, you know, because a lot of times people don't even know how to connect. You know, the question that people will often ask is, what do you do? Or they quickly want to be focused on, what can you do for me? You know, that's what how most people's interactions start, rather than showing up and figuring out how what you can do for someone else, how you can take your skills and offer to someone. When new people are coming into the industry, there are, you know, my response is, the best way to get a start in this space is figuring out how to take your gifts, take your unique skills, and figure out how to put those into service to help others. And what will end up happening when you approach situations this way is you're going to end up with the best people around you, because you're not focused on, you know, what am I going to get out of the situation? You're focused on, how can I make an impact and help you? And that leads to good things when you pay it forward. You know, I talk about this often, which is I don't think of a billionaire as someone with $1 billion. I think of a billionaire as someone that's positively impacting the lives of 1 billion people, which I think probably almost every person in this room is a future billionaire in that context, because we are working on things that are going to positively impact the lives of billions of people. You know, just the basic financial inclusion alone will radically change the lives of everyone on the planet and give them opportunities that they haven't had. And it's really exciting. Like, lucky us. And so I'm not playing the game that most people play. Like when you look at the Forbes 400 list, these are people that have mastered this game that I call compounding interest, which is playing the game of self-interest, figuring out how to do things to benefit yourself. And I'm playing the game of compounding impact, which is how do you go make the biggest positive impact in the world that you can. One other thing is that we spend a lot of time talking about technology. Technology in this space obviously is the underpinning of almost everything that we do, but we're also building open source systems, so the technology doesn't really differentiate you that much. As an open source system, anyone can copy paste. The real impact that comes from this space isn't the technology, because all it does is provide a first mover advantage. It's ultimately in the community that you build, develop, foster. And you know, how do you build communities? This is a really cool sort of piece on how to do that.
If you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore, it's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. See, it takes guts to be a first follower. You stand out, you brave ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut, and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers, because new followers emulate followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over-glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit, but you saw what really happened. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement, if you really care, is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
This is often lost on a lot of people in this space. Community, community, community is everything. What makes these projects succeed and what will separate the winners from the losers is your ability to build community. The community is everything. And how do you build a good community? Obviously, with some of these lessons here. But it's ultimately about stewardship. anytime you're evaluating, you know, what you're going to do next in your project, it is, how is this good for my community? Is this what's best for my community? And if you're always asking yourself that question, you know, that'll keep you on the right path. You're always putting the community first, yourself second. If you continually do these types of things, you know, this is what will lead to long-term success. It's all about the community and more or less everything done in this space. How many of you are familiar with sacred geometry? Okay, not many. So sacred geometry, well, these symbols here are what are known as the five Platonic solids. So Socrates was killed for revealing, you know, some of the knowledge that was given to him through the ancient mystery schools. And Plato then ended up releasing most of Socrates' knowledge in an encrypted fashion. But these five symbols are what are known as the Platonic solids, something that you might enjoy studying later. I'm not going to dive too deep into it. How many of you know what this is? Some of you probably have received gifts from me over the, the years. But what you have here, the outer shape there, is what's known as the chestahedron, which is the logo of EOS, but the chestahedron was not designed by us. The chestahedron was designed by Frank Chester, which is sacred geometry that was lost and only rediscovered in the year 2000. It's essentially a seven-sided Platonic solid, but the chestahedron is the sacred geometry of the heart, not just a cool symbol. What sits inside that is what's known as the decatria. And interestingly, they add up to the size of the earth. And if you take the word earth, and you take the last letter H and you move it to the front, it becomes heart. These things are all connected. Anyone know what this is? The fly hut, Burning Man. I just got here from Burning Man. this was Burning Man just wrapped up on Monday. So, or whatever, less than a week away. But yeah, Burning Man is really relevant to the things that we do in this space. I always talk about the blockchain as the enabling technology that is going to lead to the change in the world that most of us are at least somewhat familiar with. But I talk about Burning Man being the culture. I mean, Burning Man is the greatest experiment in decentralization. You know, it's in some ways kind of the spiritual capital of the world. Certainly the biggest art event on Earth. And it's a place where money doesn't exist. It's a place where we experiment with alternative forms of societal structures. Definitely something I recommend everyone check out. And for those that don't, here's a little preview of what it looks like.
Let's suppose that you were able every night to dream any dream you wanted to dream. And that you could, for example, have the power within one night to dream 75 years of time. We would have every kind of pleasure we could foresee. Let's have a surprise. Let's have a dream which isn't under control. Well, something is going to happen to me that I don't know what it's going to be. Then you would get more and more adventurous, and you would make further and further out gambles as to what you would dream. And finally, you would dream where you are now.
So the guy speaking there is Alan Watts. If you're not familiar with him, you may want to look up some of his work. This is a piece taken by a friend of mine, Peter Ruprecht, some of you have met. The art is made by Laura Kimpton. It was interesting. So Peter had been an economist by education, McKinsey consultant, business guy, that all of a sudden one day said, I want to be an artist. And he's spent the next 7 years being a photographer. He's probably the most iconic photographer from Burning Man. But he was having that moment as, you know, all of his money is running out and he's out at the trash fence, as we call it, and asking, you know, have I made the right decision? You know, I've gone down this path, am I doing the right thing? And he's like, give me a sign. And in that moment, the sun breaks through the clouds. This is at sunrise. And he jumps on his bike that was souped up by SpaceX, goes like 50 miles an hour, but it looks like a normal bike. And he's jolting over here. He gets here and he sees this like beautiful sunlight around this image. And he's like, ah, but you know, anyone can get this shot. He's like, show me more of a sign. And in that moment, this double-decker art car comes driving up and people get off one by one and start forming to this pose with no music. He's like, who is this photographer that organized this at sunrise? And there's no photographer. He's like, and as an artist, he's being respectful of someone else's shot. He's not gonna take it. He's like, where's the photographer? And no one's coming. There's no music. They're all just holding this pose. And he's like, is this for me? He snaps one shot and in that moment, the bus comes back and picks everyone up. And it was just an unusual moment. Dream, you know, team work makes the dream work. It takes all of us. We're doing this together. Rising tides. This is one of the things I'm not a fan of maximalists of any token. You know, to be a maximalist of something this early in the game is a lot like religious fanaticism. Didn't we learn over the last few thousand years that my chain is not better than your chain? We're all experimenting. We're all trying to make a positive impact in the world. And if any of us is successful in changing the world for the better, we all win. You know, remember to help each other. Remember to support each other to the extent you can, unless you think someone is a bad actor doing bad things. You know, I already covered the earth. This was my wedding at Burning Man a few years ago. All unicorns. We'll skip through this. And I'll touch briefly on Puerto Rico. Please come down there. I'll be in Puerto Rico most of the next 6 months. The main problem that Puerto Rico has had is that it lost a huge percentage of its population. And those were the people with the means, those with the intellectual capital, the human capital, the spiritual capital, the financial capital. Those are the people that left. And then there's been no opportunity for the college kids that are graduating. And Puerto Rico has the number 15 engineering school. This is where NASA, Google, Facebook, you know, come to recruit. But as young people, when you graduate, if you want to do something meaningful in your life, you've had to leave. So when the top of the market, you know, when the leaders are leaving and when the future leaders are all leaving, you know, that's a brain drain. And the only way to compete with a brain drain or to remedy a brain drain is with a brain gain. There's thousands of us, 4,000 of us in the process who are ahead moved to Puerto Rico, 4,000 people like us, and a lot more on the way. Come down and visit us. We have another event the last week of October and then mid-December and then a massive event again in March. But stuff in Puerto Rico, Philippines is another area of focus for me, South Korea as well. Switch is a project in the space that's putting a solar peace park into the demilitarized zone. So putting blockchain-based peer-to-peer energy grid in the DMZ, you know, which would be the, instead of the Berlin Wall east-west, this is the border between the North and South Korea. And I think there's some potential for unification of the Korean Peninsula in the next decade. But never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. And I will close and go into Q&A with one last thing. This was a tribute to
when we see
Stephen Hawking.
Space, we see ourselves as a whole. We see the unity and not the divisions. One planet. One human race. We are not the same, but we are one. We are here together, and we need to live together with tolerance and respect. Our only boundaries are the way we see ourselves. The only borders, the way we see each other. We must become global citizens. Our voices are important. We give our elected officials their power. And we can take it away. Be involved. We are all time travelers, traveling together into the future. But let us make that future a place we want to visit. Be brave. Be determined. Overcome the odds. It can be done.
And if anyone ever wonders, I mean, Stephen Hawking, this is someone that most people would say has no ability to make a positive impact in the world considering his condition. Stephen Hawking can go on to do the things, you know, he's done in the condition he was in. It means you can do anything. we're wrapping up, or we're going to try to do a moment of Q&A.
Do a Q&A. One fun one then. All right, so I absolutely appreciate and love your positivity on this, and I'm going to be a contrarian.
Fun.
So we've recently seen the Petrocoin launch in Venezuela, a hyperinflation country, fragile state, 95% devaluation of the Bolivar. Now, my question is, if the Petro works, what will happen? What are your thoughts? And also, will this spread to other dictatorial states with strong men under neo-patrimonialist governments? And so what are your thoughts on that?
Well, the Petro dollar is not working. The Petro coin is not working because of who released it. It's not you have counterparty risk. You know, it's not a decentralized system. It's a counterparty risk, and you're dealing with the Venezuelan government, and you trust the Venezuelan government to perform. And the market has spoken that they do not trust this government. So, I mean, unfortunately for Venezuela, it's a very, very, very sad situation. It's probably going to continue to get worse before it gets better. And we're starting to see, currency drops in substantial ways in places like Turkey. Argentina's back at it again. And the emperor has no clothes.
So as a follow-up to that then, absolutely. So it's a difficult situation, obviously, but in Venezuela, specifically with Bitcoin, would you believe that Bitcoin could come in, potentially be a solver of that situation? But if so, would it be through a means of exchange or store of value?
Well, Bitcoin is incredibly popular in Venezuela. For the size of market it is, it's probably, it might be the best performing Bitcoin market in the world relative to the economy in which it's operating. Because people are desperately trying to buy anything as a store of value. I mean, they'll buy electronics. They'll buy phones and stereos and televisions as a store of value, because anything to get rid of your Bolivar. That's not an example that I think is relevant to most places. Bitcoin is more of a store of value. It's more like gold 2.0 than it is a currency today. Things that are this volatile do not make good sort of tools for a medium of exchange. Not to say that Bitcoin may not be able to do that well in the future, but at this time, it's more of a store of value than it is a currency or a tool for a medium of exchange. But as the market gets bigger, when you go from a smaller cap to a very large cap sort of commodity of sorts, that could all change. I think I'm a big fan of gold again. Something were to happen with the world's currencies, and we were to see some sort of collapse in the currency markets, which I think is possible. I think that most likely the world will go back to gold in the short term. Our stuff is still not ready, but we're getting there.
So were you the lone nut in Puerto Rico?
There's a bunch of us. I like to think of it as, we're first followers of Satoshi.
Absolutely.
We are all Satoshi. Satoshi is female.
Thank you so much, Doc. Everybody.
Thank you.